Hi, welcome back to the Windows 8.1 UX Design Jumpstart. I'm Chris Mayo. I'm a UX evangelist here at Microsoft.
I'm Martin Therion. I'm a UX evangelist with Microsoft in the Netherlands.
And in this session, we're going to be talking about windowing and talking about designing an app that works great and looks great regardless of what device you're running on. When I think about myself as an app designer, I want every single user to have that great experience regardless of what device they're using on. And in Windows, there's a wide spectrum of different kind of devices, everywhere from 8-inch tablets to 30-inch all-in-ones. So when I think about windowing, what I want to think about is having my app appear beautiful and well-crafted at all sizes, on all devices. And whether that's just based on the device itself or how the device is being used. And that includes how I'm holding the device, what the default orientation of the device, or even if it's something the user or the app's doing to create multi-windowing. So this new powerful multitasking model on Windows 8.1 makes it possible for me to have multiple apps running at the same time on the same screen or across different screens. I want that app experience to be beautiful and well-crafted regardless of the situation that's being used in. And that's what this session's all about. So, like in the other sessions that we've had today, let's start with a demo and show the experience before we start talking about how to design for that experience. So I'm just gonna go to the trusty sports app. I'm a huge sports fan, so it's a good place to start. And you can see with this app, I'm running on a monitor here that's 1366 by 768. You can see that the app is, again, full screen, totally immersive. Content goes from edge to edge. This app happens to horizontally pan, right? And let's say that I wanted to multitask. Like I wanted to read news stories while I was, listening to music or browsing the web or, any of these things. What I can do is I can just grab that window and drag it to either side. And that puts it into this multitasking, multi-window mode, right? And that was for me as the user taking that action. And you can see they've adjusted the layout just a little bit, right? The size of that photo, right? The app still goes from the top to the bottom of the screen. It's just a little bit narrower. And for this app, they just kept that horizontal layout, really easy tuning of the layout to make it work at that smaller size. And it works all the way down to its minimum size. So you can see here when I start dragging the gutter and it stops moving, that's at the minimum size for this app, which for this app in Windows 8.1, the default minimum size is 500 pixels. If your app is very multitasking centric, like a couple of apps we'll look at here in a second, you might want to opt into a 320 pixel minimum window size. But you can see here down to the minimum, the app is still completely full featured and looks great and works great. I can navigate, into these stories and back, and the nav bar still works great. You can see it's just using more pagination now, right, to get through the different categories. You can see the app bar down here at the bottom still works great, tuned for that layout. And if I want to launch another app, I just click over here in this other area, and I'll just grab like the reading list app, right? And now they're running side by side. And one of the things that's new in Windows 8.1 is the fact that app windows are no longer fixed size. So in Windows 8, there was two sizes. Well, you could be full screen, you could be snapped 320 pixels to the side, or you could be filled, which is using the rest of the monitor. But now in Windows 8.1, these apps are variable in size, right? And you can see here, that was kind of subtle, so I'll do it again. So the reading list app, when it's in multitasking mode or multi-window mode, just works the exact same, right? Until the subtle change in layout, where when the height of the window becomes greater than the width, they go into a tall mode, right? And become vertically scrolling, and they tune the layout of the individual content items to look great at this particular window size. If I scroll down all the way to that minimum size, that 320 pixels, because the reading list, it's all about helping you get back to those news stories that you wanted to read that you might have missed. So it makes sense for it to be a 320 pixel app that you would keep on the screen like all the time, right? And you can see here that they've tuned the layout again for this narrow layout, this 320 pixel layout. And if you look at that gutter, you can see the little bar that shows which app is the active app. And that is useful if you want to go over to the settings charm and use settings. The settings you can see are for the reading list app because that was whatever the active app was at the time. Right? So charms work the same, everything works the same. Now if I go back to that tall window or that full screen mode, you can see that it's this windowing multitasking can happen based on a user action or it can be happen based on the functionality of the app. So if I wanted to read this story, I just click on it, and it readjusts the layout of my app. I can tell Windows, hey, you know, I want you to launch whatever app handles this protocol. In this case, it's IE11 for the URL. And I can tell it how I want that window to be laid out to my relative to my window. And then I adjust my layout to be this 320-pixel layout, this narrow layout, so I can just flip between all the different stories that I wanted to read. All right, so it can also be based on actions that the user takes within the app, right? Now here's the mail app. This is a multi-column layout where I have, you know, my different folders and people and Hotmail accounts over here, work account and so on. I've got a column for all the items in that folder, and then another app here or a mail here with a bunch of photos in it and then a link. Again, clicking on this is going to launch the app. The app that I have set up on my machine to deal with photos, which is the Photos app just by default. And you can see here I changed the layout to be a column layout specific to this window size and specific to navigation amongst the different stories or the different emails. So if I want to go into the email, let me unselect these guys, go into one of the emails, I'm just navigating back and forth, right? But the app still works and it works great. You can see I've tuned the app bar down here to be specific to that window size, right? Some of that happens automatically from the app bar control. Some of it's via me adjusting my layout based on just querying the screen and the way the screen's being, the size of the window and where it's positioned, right? And it even goes further that if I go and look at, for example, the smart search feature of Windows 8.1. You can see here that I have that horizontal pan here across the search hero, right? And if I drag this guy down here to be half the window, you can see it adjusts to that tall layout, right? And then down to a narrow layout. So it works great regardless of, you know, the relationship between the height and the width of the window, how the window is being used. Right, and again, I can just launch apps to go side by side between each other. Okay? So there's a lot of things that are going on there. And at first it might seem a little overwhelming. You know, when you think about all these different devices and all these different considerations that you have. But what we're going to learn during the course of this session is it's really about not thinking about screen size or DPI. It's going to be really thinking about a strategy for windowing and having your app work great and look great across all the different devices and all the different ways an app can be used. So if we think about some of the things that are new in Windows 8.1, apps are resizable down to a minimum width. So the default minimum width is 500 pixels. If your app is going to be used in a multitasking scenario quite a bit, it's good to invest in the optional minimum 320 pixel width. This was a fixed size we called snap state, but now it's a minimum size because the windows are variable in width. The height is always going to be the height of the screen, right? So if you design for different screen sizes, as we'll see here in a second, your app's always going to work great relative to the height of the window. You can have multiple app windows per screen, and that can be based on either something the user does to have multiple apps running side by side or based on what an app does, like we saw on reading list, click on that news story. It opens the, you know, whatever app is associated with that particular file protocol or app protocol, like IE11 for a URL. It can also be amongst the same app. So you can have a Windows, you can have an app main window and have open another window for the same app. Like we see that in Mail where you can have the Mail app running next to an app that you're composing, right? So you can see them side by side and they're actually the same app. And by designing each page to work well in this windowing mode, it's always going to work great regardless of how the user's using it. And what we're going to be thinking about is designing in terms of width versus height and thinking about a strategy rather than a screen size, right? Because if you design with a strategy will apply for all the scenarios versus getting kind of immersed in thinking about, okay, I'm going to do this pixel layout for this screen size and so on. So let's think about all the different considerations that we have to have in our mind when we're thinking about this windowing strategy, and then we'll see how the strategy applies to it. So the first thing you need to think about is screen size. So Windows runs on a wide spectrum of devices. Everything out, you know, from a small 8-inch slate that you're going to carry around, you know, with you in your bag, to a convertible, to a laptop, to a desktop, to maybe even a large screen all-in-one. I'm just clicking through some of these different screen sizes so you can see all the different screen sizes that, you know, you might come across as a Windows Store app developer. And if we start back from the beginning, you can see that can go from a 10-inch slate, or 10-inch device that's 1024 by 768, to 11-inch 1366 by 768. And notice the subtle things that are going on with this content, where as the screen gets bigger, I start showing bigger content and more content. As we go up all the way to this 30-inch screen where I'm showing a lot of content at once, you know, so people can see a lot of news stories or a lot of headlines in this example. So we'll talk about some of those different strategies as we talk about screen size. We also need to think about window width. So it might not just be the width of the device itself, but you can see here I've got two different monitors that are hooked up to my my desktop back in my office. It's got a 1920 by 1080 screen, so I can show, you know, four windows on each monitor, right? Including, you know, some desktop applications, like you can see Excel here in that second from the left, right? Mixed in with different Windows Store apps. Window height and the relationship between the height and the width of the window is something I want to plan for within that strategy. So, you know, regardless of whether it's a landscape device that's turned into a portrait mode or being held in portrait mode, or it's a window, side-by-side window where the height is greater than the width, like this 1366 by 768 screen, I need to think about that as being one of the scenarios that I support. Screen DPI is another consideration. We talked about all those different screen sizes in the beginning just a couple slides ago. But here's an example of two different devices. Both have an 11-inch screen, 11.6-inch screen, but have totally different DPIs. One's 1366 by 768. The other one's 1920 by 1080. And if Windows didn't automatically account for scaling, you know, you could see how in these two different images, you know, the buttons would get really small, the touch targets would get really small, the app would become a lot less usable. But what Windows does out of the box is does automatic scaling, so the touch targets will all look the same size, the fonts will scale to the same size. If you have static images, it can do substitution to provide higher fidelity images for those greater DPI screens. We'll talk about that, but you need to think about DPI and understand what Windows provides for you so you can leverage that engine again so your app always looks great and works great.
Yeah, and it's a setting in Windows, right? So yeah. I can switch on a bigger monitor or with higher resolution, I can switch between show it small or show it like readable.
Right, right. And it can be the same device. Like I had, you know, I have my Surface, which is, yeah, you know, 1366 by 768, and I can plug that into a 27-inch monitor, yeah, right, and using all the same apps, right? And my expectation as a user and my goal as a designer, that regardless of what the device is or whether it's connected to an external monitor or internal monitor or whatever, that it's always going to look and work great.
Yeah.
Okay? So let's start at the beginning. And what we're going to do is we're going to kind of take each one of these steps for that strategy and start very simple and then add more advanced windowing concepts as we go on until the point where we have a strategy that's going to work for every app and every device. So we're going to start by just designing the primary layout. And probably the easiest place to start is 1366 by 768. It's the most common screen size and the most common DPI. It's also the base resolution that we use for the scaling engine within Windows. So you're going to select a panning direction based on your particular scenario. Again, we talked about this earlier. The default guideline for panning is along the long edge, right? So if it's a 16 by 9, it's in landscape mode, along the long edge would be horizontal. If it's in portrait mode, you know, you would want that to be the long edge, would be a vertical pan. But that's the default. You really need to think about your scenarios, like i.e., even when it's being used on a, you know, a big monitor like this, you know, 23-inch monitor, it's a browser, and the expectation is that browsers pan up and down, right? So it makes sense that for that scenario, you're going to come up with a panning direction that's specific to the app scenario and not about, you know, the guidelines. So think about that. Next, you want to have a strategy for adapting the screen sizes. So you start with 1366 and you design all the pages, and then you start annotating the pages and the sketches and actually going through and saying, on a pixel perfect level, where are these apps going to take advantage to these different screen sizes as they move up? Okay. So the first thing we need to do is think about a strategy between, is my app going to be an adaptive app, where the layout's going to adapt intentionally with changes in screen size? Or am I going to be a fixed app, where I want to have, you know, the same fixed page layout regardless of what the screen size is? So for an adaptive layout, I want to think proportionally. And I want to think about what portions of this page will be fixed and what portions of these page will be adaptive. So as the content is used and as the app is used on different devices, is the header and maybe this description panel fixed and the content area is adaptive? So maybe it pans along that long edge for a horizontally panning app, and as the screen gets larger, or if I move the app to other screens like that surface plugging in a 27-inch monitor, what portion of that screen is going to adapt and how is it going to adapt? And really, we have a couple of different strategies that we can think about for using that adaptive space. Do I want to show more content? Do I want to make the content bigger? Do I want to manage the white space? And honestly, it's going to be a combination. It's going to be, according to your scenarios, you're going to pick one, many, or all of these particular options. So for showing more content for like a map, if I go from, you know, a 10-inch screen to a 23-inch screen, you know, it makes sense that I would want to just show more map, right? Showing more content. Maybe I want to make the content bigger, like this example of the store, where I want to take each of those images and make them, you know, 30% bigger, moving to a larger monitor, right? And just show more detail. Maybe I want to manage some of the white space. So there's a point where, you know, the amount of content that I'm showing and the size of the content would become a little overwhelming. So I just want to manage the white space a little bit to kind of frame that content within the screen.
Yeah, and you see that in this example, that because it's almost like centered, right?
Yeah.
That, but it still gives a good feel of the page. And if it would be at the top of the page, then you would have this big empty space.
It's just abyss of space,
yeah,
right?
And yeah, it's something broken.
Right.
And in this way, it feels like it's a message to the user. This is actually what the data is or what the content is.
Yeah, it's all about that intentional craftsmanship.
Exactly.
Okay. So once I kind of have that strategy and I have that idea in my head on what portions of the screen are going to be adaptive, I can leverage the templates and the built-in controls that have, again, like we had talked about in some of the earlier sessions, have built-in support for these scenarios. So the templates that you're going to see if you do File New Project in Visual Studio or somebody on your development team does, you'll see that the templates themselves are divided into, one, the page, like in this HTML page, it's using, the content host uses the entire width and the entire height of the page. And I'm defining fragments with different columns for, you know, the rows for the banner or the header and then the body. The next fragment, I'm defining that column for the back button and the page title, and then the rest of it, that fragment that's defined as the section with a roll of main, that goes in that, you know, second row over, second column down, and that's the entire content area. And it uses up the 100% of that content area, and whatever content I fill in there will automatically start scrolling and panning for me. And same thing with the XAML templates. If you crack those open, it's a great way to learn kind of how layout is done within a Windows app or for your development team. So you can see the definition of the rows, like 140 pixels or 7 units for that top row. Everything else is used up for the next row. And then for the columns, I'm going to take that column width to be auto, and it's just going to automatically size for that that back button and its margins. And then that next column over, I'm going to put the header, and then that's, you know, the column below that, or the row below that's where I'm going to start having content. Okay? And the templates, they're defined out of the box for adaptive layout. The controls themselves support it as well. So if I have a list view control that in the first example is, let's say that's a 10-inch screen, 1366 by 768, and the next one's a 23-inch monitor, you know, 1920 by 1080. What's the right thing to do? Well, it just reflows the content, right? So I go from two rows by three columns to being able to show three rows with two columns, right? And I can just show more content, and the list view control will automatically adapt for you to show as much content based on the item template in the space that it has available. Same thing with multi-column text. I can just show more text and more columns the more screen real estate that I have. And that's just built into the controls, right? So if you look at a list view in HTML, I can define the grouped item page.groupItemList.item. So this is the item template, right? And I can give it a height of 250 pixels and a width of 250 pixels. And if I apply that to my grouped items list, when the page renders, it's automatically going to show as many of those 250 pixel by 250 pixel content items as it possibly can for that particular screen size. And same thing for XAML, right? Where I can define an item template like this standard 250 by 250 item template, right? With its width of 250 pixels and height of 250 pixels. And then I can apply that to my grid view, right, as the item template for it, and it'll automatically do the rendering to show as many of the content items as it can for that particular screen size.
But it's a great help in having a responsive design that's also used in web design, and have the same things applied to building Windows apps and make it very easy to scale up to from small to very large.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's the same things that we've learned for responsive design for the web, just applied to this particular platform. And again, a lot of it's built into the controls, so it's just a matter of having a strategy and then applying that strategy. So let's just look at a quick example. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go to the desktop. I'm going to launch this tool that ships with Visual Studio, and it's called the simulator. And what the simulator does is it actually creates a new session logged into my machine, right? And gives me the ability to change aspects of that session. You can see I can set all these different screen sizes and screen resolutions to test my app and make sure it always works great. So let me go over here. And let's go ahead and just grab like one of the apps, like we'll go with sports again. Right? So this is what the screen would look like at the default resolution. So it's a 10.6 inch screen, right? And it's 1366 by 768. And you can see here, if we scroll over, right, you can see how many rows and columns of content that I have in top stories. Right? And if I go up in DPI, you can see it automatically just accounts for it and it looks the same. Right, which is good because I don't want my UI to be affected or the touch targets to be affected with DPI. But then let's go all the way up to a 27-inch monitor. Right, look at how much more content. So they're tuning the size of the content, right, in that hero picture. They're tuning how many items I can see. You can see I'm seeing, you know, approximately twice as many news stories, maybe, you know, four times as many news stories here on an individual page. So it's using the full size of the device, and it's, you know, leveraging every single pixel for that story. So that simulator gives me the ability to use all sorts of things. So I can test different DPIs, I can test different screen sizes, I can rotate the device. It's got a neat feature where I can take a screenshot. So if you know, one of the pages of my app doesn't look great, I can take a screenshot and attach that to the bug.
Yeah, or use it for your store submission.
Yeah, exactly, right? And it simulates touch if you don't have a touch device. So a lot of great things going on in the simulator. And I just wanted to show just an example of one of the first party or inbox apps for Windows, like Sports or Travel or Bing, and show how it adapts for that adaptive layout to always look great and work great across screen sizes. So maybe I'm creating a game and I want to have a fixed layout, right? So it doesn't make sense, you know, for a app like a chess app to show, you know, more pieces and a larger board.
Could be interesting.
Yeah, though. It could be interesting, right? Just like the 3D chess, you know, in science fiction movies and so on. But It makes sense to actually just scale to fit for a fixed layout application. What we do is we use the Viewbox control for that and just scale it to fit. And if the aspect ratio doesn't exactly map to the individual aspect ratio of the device, we can use letterboxing to and the background of the app to make it always retain that aspect ratio and always look great. And really the thing that I need to think about is anytime I'm providing a fixed size asset, like you can see these logos over here on the side, I always want to supply the largest size and scale down rather than supplying the smallest guys and scaling up and ending up with, like you'll see here, this loss of resolution, this kind of low quality look to that graphic on the right hand side. So just to show that very quickly, I'm just going to go to a game, cut the rope, and you can see here it's all fixed screen. I just installed this just a second ago, so it'll take a second to start up for the first time. All right, and it's full screen and it works great, and we all know how to play Cut the Rope. It's a fantastic game, right? So that's the game just running on my full screen here, right? And I can go ahead and play the game and test it out and so on. But let's go ahead and look at this in the simulator and then see it across all of these different screen sizes. And we'll see that the app still works great and looks great because the team did a great job of creating a fixed box layout that was always playable regardless of the screen size. So let me start off at that base resolution of 1366 by 768. And we'll launch Cut the Rope again. Okay, so here it is running, and you can see that the aspect ratio is right for this. So it looks great. Let me try going to like 1024 by 768 so you can see the letterboxing automatically reflows the layout. And I know it's a little herky-jerky there because it's you're actually changing the resolution on the fly. But you know, going to a 23-inch machine with the right aspect ratio, the 16:9 aspect ratio takes the full screen and so on. So you can see that the game itself, it's fixed in size and always works great and always plays great regardless of what the screen size is, you know? So whether it's on this 23-inch monitor that I'm playing at home, or I'm on the plane, and maybe I'm using my 8-inch device, it's always going to work great and it's always going to look great. So I can play away to my heart's content, that long flight to the Netherlands or whatever. Okay? So just a great example there of an app that, you know, applied the strategy and did a great job of creating an app that was always playable and always beautiful. Okay. So once I have that design strategy and that layout strategy for different screen sizes, next I can start thinking about designing for window sizes and different window widths.
Should be window size.
It should be. So designing for window width is all about thinking about that default minimum or the default minimum and up. So we start with thinking about 500 pixels and above, right? And this can come about from multiple windows per screen, multiple windows per app. A user action, you know, like we had seen dragging and dropping to open multiple apps on the same screen at the same time. It can happen from the app itself, like opening that photo from the mail that we had seen, or reading list app opening the web page. Or it can be multiple windows from a single application, like we had seen like with the mail app, being able to open a mail in another window so I can compose the mail while I'm still watching my feed of mail that's coming in. So the default minimum size is 500 pixels. It'll always be 500 pixels and up is always going to be full functionality. You want to make the resize just feel really, really natural and not disruptive so the user can just size the window however they want and knowing that the app's always going to work great. And what we do is we start with that primary layout. And in some cases, we don't have to do anything at all, just like you saw in the sports app. So I can have my primary layout defined like here in XAML. Like I have a visual state defined for primary layout, and that's my primary layout that I designed for the screen size portion of the strategy. Now, on Windows 8, I would be thinking about fixed sizes. So I'd be asking, is my application view state equal to dot filled every time, you know, the Windows side changed event fires off? In Windows 8.1, I'm just going to ask, is the window size dot width greater or equal to 500 pixels? And if it is, I'm going to apply that primary layout. Now, in HTML, we're going to use media queries. We talked about responsive design. That should be familiar to all the web developers out there. Or I can just say, in my CSS, if the media is screen and it's MS view state filled, that's what I do in Windows 8. And they'll be asking about that filled or that fixed sized window. But now I'm just going to ask, is the minimum width 500 pixels in Windows 8.1? And if it's above 500 pixels, I'm going to just define my primary layout there. And that'll get applied whenever the window is 500 pixels and up. So what are some of the strategies I can think about for designing for 500 pixels and up? Well, the first one is just adapting horizontal space. So if I've got a horizontally panning app, I can just keep the primary layout. Like we saw with the sports app, it horizontally pans, and 500 pixels and up, it just works exactly the same, right? You just pan to the right, and they did a little bit of tuning, like to make sure that the peak always lined up so I could see that there was more content and kind of inviting me to go see that more content. But you could see just from that particular app, horizontal panning and adjusting that width for 500 pixels and up, it was really easy. I really didn't have to do a whole heck of a lot. Now, if I've got a vertical pan and I've got multi-column, like within the Mail app, I probably have to do a little bit more work. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tune to adapt for that horizontal space by taking those columns and intelligently showing or hiding columns based on where the user is in the app, and then allowing them to navigate back and forth from the columns. And we saw that in the Mail app, where, you know, for example, I'd be asking in XAML or XAML in C# if the size of the window is less than 600 and I had three 200 pixel columns, I'd hide one of them and provide navigation so they could navigate from, you know, the list of mails to the mail and back and so on. Just like an HTML CSS, I'd be asking if the media query, its screen and the max width is 500 pixels, 599 pixels, then I'd start showing and hiding the columns or rearranging and stacking them and then providing the right navigation in order to get back and forth. And again, we saw this with the mail application as a great example. Here I've got all the different folders and all the different emails in that particular folder, and I'm enjoying this mail, and I go down to be half screen, and then it starts providing just a single column, so I have that great reading experience, and it's easy for me to navigate back and forth between the different mails, right? And even see a little bit of tuning here. The mail team did a great job here. If I get beyond a certain width, then it collapses down that folder, right? So it's even easier. I can still use it. It's still a full functioning app, but it works great at that resolution. Okay. So yeah, we just showed that with the vertical pan and multi-column. So designing for 500 pixels and up, adapting for horizontal space when I'm a fixed layout, this is really just leveraging the primary layout. I've already got that view box, and it's doing the right letterboxing for me to adjust for the aspect ratio. And here you can see I'm in multi-windowing mode, and I'm running Cut the Rope, and it still works and plays great. Maybe I have, you know, TV on the other side, and I'm watching TV or listening to music or something in the other window, right? But I can still play my game. So when I think about designing for vertical space and that 500 pixels and up, really this is just about primary layout, adapting to vertical space for screen sizes. So like for, you know, the travel app, if I'm adjusting showing more content or showing larger content or managing white space, I'm automatically, just by accounting for screen size, I'm automatically taking care of that vertical space, so I don't have any extra work to do here. So the next thing that I need to think about is whether I want to support a narrow layout. And when we think about, you know, all the different devices and all the different opportunities to delight users on those devices, this is a really smart thing to do because I can tailor the UI for the user on the app as they want to use it, whether it's based on the device or multitasking or whatever. So it's a really good idea. When I'm designing for 500 pixels and below, right, the default minimum is 500 pixels. I can opt into a 320 pixel minimum if it makes sense for like a multitasking app. And that might be, you know, an app that's a list app like Reading List or an inbox like email or a social app. you know, that I'm going to be monitoring feeds or status of something. And I really want to focus on the core scenarios. I might not be able to provide all the scenarios within my app in this small 320 pixels, but if I provide the core scenarios, there's a good chance that the users are going to keep my app open and running on the machine for a longer period of time because it works great in that small window while they're doing other things. So what I want to do, if I've got a Windows 8 app, I would start with the Windows 8 snap layout. If not, we'll talk about how to design for this narrow layout. If I want to design for the 320 pixel or support that, I override the default within my project, and developers will know how to do that, just a setting. And then I adjust the layout for a narrow window. And this is the same guidance that we gave for Snap, where I reduce the size of margins, the size of the back button and the header text, and then adjust the layout for each individual item based on the screen size and based on my content. Now, if you're coming from Windows 8, you'll want to know that there's no programmatic unsnap anymore. We leave the user in control so they can unsnap the window. So, you know, communicating scenarios to the user is really about showing or hiding features, whether it's on app bars or commands and so on, to the point where they kind of understand that, oh, this is what I can do in narrow layout versus something I'd have to go to a full screen or a larger screen in order to get it done. We'll show an example of that with the recording app. So if I'm supporting, if I've got a Windows 8 app today and I don't upgrade to or update it for Windows 8.1, Snap will still work. It'll letterbox the app from 320 pixels up to 500 pixels, and then it'll apply the next larger layout. Once I retarget my app for Windows 8.1, then I can use the adaptive layout, and it'll actually won't pillarbox, and the app will just fill the window. So Windows 8.0 and 8.1 narrow layout for XAML, I would define the narrow layout as just a new visual state, right? And then in Windows 8, I would have asked, you know, if the window size changed and whether my app was snapped or filled. But in Windows 8.1, of course, I want to say, is the size of the window less than, for example, 500 pixels for this particular app, if it was going to support 500 pixels below down to 320.
And maybe it's also good to notice that when you make the size of the window smaller, it doesn't redraw all the time,
yeah,
but it starts redrawing when you release the snap bar,
right,
or the
gutter.
The gutter.
Yeah.
And then you get the repaint of the application.
Right, yeah, you get the event and you can decide, you know, through media query or
exactly
through the size change event exactly what layout you want to apply. Okay, and in HTML, same thing. It's media queries in CSS where I asked in Windows 8 whether it's snapped. We don't have fixed sizes anymore. So really what we want to think about is the max width being 499 pixels, right? And if it's below that, that's where I define my narrow layout styles. Okay. Now, a lot of the controls out of the box support tuning of the control for these narrow layouts. So probably the best example is the app bar spacing. At 1366, I would have, you know, a wider 40-pixel gap between those two, and then I'd have the labels. If I go down to 500 pixels, the app bar automatically drops them. And if I'm getting smaller than that, where I can't show all the buttons, then that's where I want to create another layout specific to that window size and say, okay, you know, I'm only going to support these core scenarios for this particular window size. All right, and that's something that you're going to design in your visual design. Again, using the same thing that we've learned with doing responsive for the web.
Or maybe have a more button so you can click on it and have a fly out with the other options.
Yeah. So let's look at an example of that. So if I go to the alarms app, there's something you're going to notice about this as well, right? Where here I am, I'm full screen, I'm horizontally panning. There you go, partially screen. Now, one thing that you're going to notice there is that the navigation up at the top changed from being different clickable buttons into a dropdown, right? Just making better use of that space, right? And just a simple thing to do that works all the way down to the 320 pixel minimum. And this is something like an alarms app or a timer app, like I'm taking a practice test or, you know, I'm timing my kid running around that track or something along those lines. I'd want this app running all the time, so it makes sense to have this app actually tuned to be a multitasking type app, right? And same thing for, let's say, that sound recorder app that I had mentioned. If I launch this app, you can see, like, let's go to, okay, here's a sound clip that I just, you know, recorded. starting a new sound clip, it's just a matter of, I don't have a microphone connected to this machine. It's just a matter of touching on this button, so an on-page command. And then I can modify it just by selecting here, and I can either play it, right? I can adjust where the app is. I can trim it if I want to, tag off or take off a little bit on the beginning and the end, say okay, update the original, right? And then note that as I go half screen, like some of the commands, like the trim command, would be really hard to do on like a 10-inch device and trying to grab those handles and so on. But still being able to, seek and play and pause, as well as, name and delete that particular clip makes a lot of sense. At the 320 pixel, maybe I'm listening to recorded lectures and stuff like that, I can play and pause. There's really not enough screen real estate. I can communicate where the clip is with this orange bar, but not really enough screen real estate that I could do that trimming or that seek within the clip. So the app is automatically accounting for different screen sizes. Some of it's automatic, like dropping these labels in the app bar, right? And some of it's a layout change, like intentionally hiding different controls.
And that's also thinking about scenarios. Mm-hmm. So this is a different view. It's in a different situation where you have different core scenarios for the same app.
Right, which is, if you think about it, like for this app, if I couldn't, at that smaller screen size, if I couldn't, play or record sound, the app really wouldn't be that useful, right? But not being able to edit and trim at this screen size, that's okay, right? Because I can still, like, let's say I was playing a lecture and I was taking notes on the other side or something along those lines. It's really about thinking about those core scenarios and making sure that your core scenarios are always work great and always look great regardless of the screen size. And that's a solid point. Okay. So the next thing I want to do is think about optionally supporting a tall layout. And again, this is optional, right? But it's something that really can be a delighter for your users, right? If they're running on, an 8-inch slate that's traditionally a portrait-held device, or they've taken the keyboard off their surface and they're sitting and reading, on the couch, or even if they're, running in a multi-window mode where they've got multiple apps side by side, a tall layout is all about adjusting the layout of the window for the height being greater than the width, and it could be amongst any of those scenarios, and that starting point is really the narrow layout. So if you came up with a narrow layout, whether it's 500 pixels and below or 320 pixels, that vertical panning, adjusting the fonts and the margins and the control layout is really where you start when you think about tall layout. And again, in Windows 8.1, I'm just going to ask, is the size of the window, this is XAML, and the size of the window, is the height greater than the size of the width? And if it is, I'm going to apply a tall layout visual state view, the visual state manager. And Windows CSS, it's just a matter of saying if the media screen and the orientation is portrait. And if it is, I'm going to apply the CSS associated with my tall window layout. Okay, so let's look at an example of this. And I think that the Smart Search team did a fantastic job. Let me see if I have the San Francisco window open. I do. And we looked at this before. So long edge panning, great experience, great content layout here for this device. And then I'm going to go half screen, which is the tall layout, and it switches over to a vertical pan and adjusts the layout and the margins and some of the fonts, right? Even the layout of these individual items. Remember the button, Wikipedia button, was on the bottom and now it's on the side there, right? All the way down to the 320 pixel minimum. That's something that's really, really powerful. If you think about this app, right, that ships with the system, this app always works and looks great regardless of how I'm using it. Right, whether it's this 23-inch monitor, 30-inch monitor, 10-inch, 11-inch, whatever. It just looks great, and from a delighter standpoint, the fact that this app tunes its layout for not only the device that I'm on, but how I'm using the app on the device, they just did a really, really great job. And this is just them implementing both a narrow and a tall layout. So next I need to think about screen DPI. And a lot of this comes from Windows itself and the scaling engine that's built into Windows. But again, restating kind of the problem that we need to think about, pixel density on two different devices, even though they're both 11.6-inch screens, one could be 1366 by 768, and the other way could be 1920 by 1080. And if Windows didn't do anything, that 100 pixel by 200 pixel button would get really, really small on the 1920 by 1080 screen, to the point where you really couldn't even touch the button. And that touch target tuning that you did in your layout would, you know, not apply anymore. But what Windows does automatically is it automatically scales controls and scales fonts along different DPIs. And when we talked about that 20 pixel unit earlier in the day when we were talking about layout, that's where that really comes into play, because 20 pixel units and 5 pixel subunits automatically scale across that plateau. And same thing with that type ramp. So everything scales up and always looks great regardless of the screen DPI. Everything just looks perfectly crisp. Okay. So I want to make sure that I deliver a great experience on any screen, whether it's the size of the screen that I'm tuning for or the DPI that I'm tuning for. And Windows automatically scales it, the physical size of UI elements, and provides asset substitution across different DPI plateaus. So if I'm designing for pixel density, the layouts are scaled automatically. And if I'm using CSS primitives or SVG or scalable resources, Windows just takes care of it. I don't need to worry about like fonts and buttons and stuff like that. If I'm supplying fixed assets, the scaling plateaus across the different DPI plateaus supported by Windows will automatically substitute in the right resource as long as I follow a few simple rules. So you can see here down at the bottom of this slide, I've got an 11-inch screen that's 1366 by 768. That's 135 DPI. That's the 100% plateau. That's that base that we started with. If you move up to 1920 by 1080, that's 190 DPI, which is about 140, or about. It's exactly 140% of the 100% scale plateau. And if I move up to 11.6 and 2560 by 1440, that moves to 253 DPI, or 180%. So those different scale plateaus are something I can leverage via resource loading. So if I have fixed assets, like for example, option number one, I can provide, if I had in my markup, projector.jpg, right, that it would automatically grab that particular resource off the machine or off of resources for the app. If I want to supply different scaling plateaus, like a different JPEG for the 100% plateau, the 140% plateau, the 180% plateau, all I have to do is in my code say projector.jpg and supply the resources with this suffix on the end, scale 100, scale 140, scale 140, scale 180, and Windows will automatically substitute in the right file. Right? I can do that either by file naming convention or file folder convention. So I can go in, and the option number two would be to have a folder with all of the assets for the 100% scale, then all the assets for the 140% scale, and all the assets for the 180. And it'll automatically do the substitution for me. Okay. Now, if I have lots and lots of assets and I want to break those up and only supply them in the cases of them being used for the device, and that's whether it's based on screen size and visual assets or it's language or whatever, I can use this new thing in Windows 8.1 called resource packages, where when the user installs the device, it only installs the resource packages that apply to that device, right? So it would bring down the right assets for my 10-inch screen. If I plug in another device, it'll bring down the assets for that other monitor. Now, font scaling, again, automatic by the system. The type ramp and that 20 pixel and 5 pixel grid was designed with scaling in mind. So you can see that 20 pixels units and that 5 pixel subunits scale up to 28 pixels and 7 pixels at 1.4 for the 140% plateau, 36 pixels and 9 pixels at that 1.8 or 180% plateau. Automatically scaling to round numbers, so it just works for me. I just have to supply the right assets whenever they're fixed assets. Okay, so DPI scaling with sports. We actually looked at this earlier today, but let's just look at it one more time, where I'll go into that simulator and then just pick an app like the sports app. All right, there's the sports app. Where do we start here? So we're starting on a 4:3 aspect ratio, 140% pixel, or 140% DPI scaled device that's 1440x1080. Okay, so let's go up to 10-inch screen, and then go through, like, even looking at things like, you know, the app bars and so on. I'll take a second to refresh here. Right, like these app bar buttons and stuff like that, as well as all these assets, like the fonts and so on. If I go from the 1024x768 to 1366x768, it's just a narrower screen. But if I go up to 1920x1080, that's 140% pixel plateau. And they've got, you know, a lot of assets and a lot of content in here that they're scaling. These buttons scale automatically as of the size of these controls up here on the top, like in the nav bar and so on. And you can see I can flip through these different resolutions or DPIs, and the app always looks great and always works great, right? And they did that by either using scalable assets or providing fixed assets across the plateaus and letting Windows substitute them in for me. Okay, so a great tool for testing, as well as kind of showing that your app works great across all those different DPI and screen sizes. So there's a number of tools that help me with this. One is the simulator. The other one is Expression Blend and its support for devices. So if I go and load up Expression Blend here for a second, and this is the tool that you use to turn your comps into, you know, that front-end markup, whether it's XAML or HTML and CSS. But if I fire up Blend and just do a new project, and I'm just going to create one based on the hub template in XAML. It'll take a second to start up here. And then once it starts up, you can see that it shows me a rendering of the page as how it will look at runtime. And I can tune that, you know, by just setting properties and adding more content and so on. All right, so let's make this so it fits on the page. Okay. And then I can go to this device tab, and I have control over, at design time, all the different aspects of the different supported screens across different screen sizes, DPIs, and so on. So I can see how it will affect, how it will affect my UI, whether that's, you know, the orientation of the device, or it's how the app is being used. Oh, let me switch back over here. So whether I'm, you know, the larger portion of the screen or the smaller portion of the screen, or I'm in the middle, and I can use that to design my layout for all of these different aspects, right? So I don't even have to run the application. So we saw the simulator is a great way to test that, you know, beyond just the capabilities of my machine. Expression does that at design time. Okay? So that's windowing. And what I had mentioned in the earlier part of today, or the earlier part of this session, is it's not about screen size. It's really about having a strategy. And if you follow the strategy that we're suggesting in the guidelines and in this session, you can see that your view, that's a responsive view, can work across all of the different screen sizes and all the different window sizes that you see here, right? Regardless of how the device is being used or how the app is being used. And that's really where you want to be, is where your app always looks great and works great, regardless of the device or regardless of how it's being used. So how do I do that? Well, I start off with my primary layout. I start at 1366x768, the most common screen size, and lay out each individual screen. And then I come up, based on my scenarios, with whether my app's going to be adaptive or it's going to be a fixed layout. And I go through and define, you know, maybe in early sketches, just annotate the sketches. When I'm doing visual comps, actually lay out the screen across all the different screen sizes that I might have, and come up with a strategy. Am I going to show more content? I'm going to show larger content, or I'm going to show more white space? Or, again, like a combination of any of those three. Then I design for window size, thinking about 500 pixels and up, and then thinking about 500 pixels and below, and potentially using that 320 pixel narrow size. And that narrow window size is great for multitasking apps, like the reading list and like a mail app or a social app, where I'm going to want to have that running all the time. Okay, and I can optionally support that tall layout where the height is greater than the width. And we saw that with the search app, that that app works and looks great regardless of how I'm using it and regardless of the window size. So I can take that same narrow layout, the vertical panning, adjusting the fonts and the padding and margins and so on, to make that look great for the window size. And then I need to think about screen DPI. And as long as I'm using scaling resources, awesome. Windows is going to take care of everything. If I'm using any fixed size assets, then I can use the scaling engine across those different plateaus and get a layout that's going to work great for me. Okay? So for a lab for this, what would I want to do? Well, I'd want to take a few key screens and actually go through and kind of annotate, you know, the sketches to say, how would this, is this app going to be adaptive? Is it going to be a fixed layout? Annotate which parts of the screen are going to be dynamic and adaptive, which ones of them are going to be fixed. And then do that for, you know, let's say the hub page and the a few list pages if it's a hierarchical app, a detail page. Just get a feel for what kind of things that you're going to need to do to make that layout work great across all those different screen sizes. And then from there, take another couple of key sizes and think about designing for window size. What's going to be, what am I going to do at 500 pixels and up? What am I going to do 500 pixels below? And I'm going to support that 320 pixel layout. Do I want to do, you know, a specific narrow layout? Do I want to do that tall layout? And just kind of sketch each one of those to make sure that you kind of understand the things that you're going to need to think about within your application. Okay? So one of the things that we definitely want to do is, one, make sure that all the windowing resources, you guys see those in the slides, so guidelines for window sizes, resizing, and then pixel density. The app developers blog has a great blog post on adapting to view state changes within your app. And same thing on the Windows blog, scaling different screen sizes is a great article to read. We've got all those linked here. So definitely what we want to do is, one, remind you that there's an eval for today on the screen right away. So you can fill out that eval. We would love to get your feedback.
Positive feedback.
Positive. Right. We'd like to get honest feedback. We hope that it's positive. But please fill out that eval. And then this is just day one. So we covered a lot of ground today, but there's still more. Tomorrow we're going to start talking about contracts with search and share.
Yep.
And contacts and appointments integrating into the People app and the Calendar app. And then we'll talk about the Windows Store and just kind of some lessons learned across some of the first party apps and what the design teams did for like the Alarms app and the Calculator app and so on.
Exactly.
So, well, we really appreciate you being here today and joining us for this session, the day one sessions. Tomorrow we're going to have a lot of great information as well, so I hope you can join us at 9 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. Wherever you are in the world, we hope you can join us.
Yeah, see you tomorrow.
Thanks.
Bye.